Fellow American Catalysis Society, welcome you all to Chicago. For those of you I didn't greet personally last night at registration or at the reception, my name is Chris Marshall from Argonne National Lab. I'm the co-chair along with Robert Lassini, who was retired from Amico. We've got a very good program this week, I think. The program chair's done very well. Registration currently is running a little over 800, and we expect it to top out someplace between 850 and 900. So we've got a very good meeting. It's extremely an international meeting. The meeting represents something like 17 countries. We began work on this meeting, which is incredible, about 4 years ago. We signed a contract with the sheriff, and at that time it didn't seem like we were going to go, and come in the last couple of months it seems like it was coming on to us very quickly. But it's been going very well. We've got about 180 technical program oral sessions, and somewhere around 250 poster programs going on. A few announcements before we get started. First of all, we have additional copies of the proceedings from last summer's 11th International Catalyst Congress that was held in Baltimore, if anybody's interested. The copies originally sold for, I think, $200, and we're selling them for $25 at the registration desk. So if you're interested, we've got about a couple dozen copies of those down there. I'd like to remind all session chairs and exhibitors, if you did not pick up a ribbon with your badge, please pick up those at the registration desk so we can be able to tell you and give you special recognition that you well deserve. Regarding the layout of land, if you haven't figured it out, all technical sessions will be held on this level, okay, and we'll be subdividing this room during the break, okay, and there's up two other rooms just the other side of this movable wall. Okay, section A will be in ballroom 6, which is the back part of this room. Section B is in ballroom 10. That's different from what's printed in your booklet. It says ballroom 8. Ballroom 8 will be used as the speaker ready room. Okay, and that's back in this this corner over here. Section C is in ballroom 9, which is the middle room on the other side of the wall there. And section D is in ballroom 7, which is this room right here that we're in. As I said, the important thing is I'd like to ask people after the plenary session to please move outside because they're going to be pulling up the movable wall here and making this big room into two smaller rooms. Regarding the session chairs, please try to keep everybody on time, a maximum of 30 minutes per talk, including questions. We've got some warning lights here to turn on a yellow and red light. 11th ICC graciously provided us with. In addition, especially what the 11th ICC found is that these little laser pointers seem to have a high vapor pressure. Session chairs, please be responsible for either turning those in at the end of your session to the registration desk or to the next session chair if you know who that is. You don't want to try to lose them. These were provided to us by the 11th ICC meeting. There's one change in the program that did not get noted. It's in your packet, but I will note it. The keynote speaker for the Monday afternoon Catalyst by Design program has been changed to Charles Campbell. And Charles, we appreciate your coming in at the last minute. Regarding the exposition and poster session, those are being held three floors down in the exhibition hall. Just take the escalators down three floors and you can't miss them down there. We've got a whole bottom level for that. All of the coffee breaks, with the exception of this morning, will be held down there. This morning's coffee break will be just outside of these doors. You can't miss it out there. The banquet is on Wednesday evening, starting at 7 o'clock. There's a reception at 6 o'clock on the promenade level right here, and the banquet is going to be in this room. We'll be opened up all the way for that. We've got a special rebate offer for those not attending the banquet. If you're going to be leaving early, it's good only until noon today. If you wish to get a rebate, we're giving a $20 rebate for turning in your banquet ticket by noon. We get charged for every banquet ticket that's going out, so if you're not going to be attending, it helps to defray some of our costs. Just turn your banquet ticket into the registration desk and you'll get a $20 rebate for that. If you look at the menu, you can figure out quite easily that for $20 you're not going to replace that meal. So, with that in mind, I'd like to introduce I'd like to introduce Professor Robert Burwell. He's one of our honorary chairmen for the 15th North American meeting. We'd like to make some opening remarks. Bob is no stranger to this crew. He's an emeritus professor from Northwestern University, where he's been a professor of chemistry for the last four decades. His whole biography is written up in both the pocket and in the main guide there, so please take a look at that. He held the title, for example, of the Upadhyay Professor of Chemistry from 1970 to 1980, and his work in the elucidation of the mechanisms of catalysis in chemistry is so well noted. So, for that, I'd like to turn the floor over to Bob.
Now, I'm sure all of these chairmen would be happy to testify the amount of work that's involved, they have to do, and all their committee members. You might notice that near the bottom that I was chairman of the previous meeting in Chicago, and I'm in a particularly good position to testify to the work it takes. By the way, I would say that my present job is better than that job, and the pay is almost as good. Well, let me just give you a chance to refresh your memory. And if everybody's there fast enough, we can look at the next slide, please. Now, you may notice that one of the chairmen is italicized. That is to thank him for assembling the data I have on these two slides. And I think that job will be very useful in the future if we don't lose it. But it needs to be maintained. Thank you, Bert. And now I think all the essentials have been accomplished. We may proceed to the scientific part of the meeting. And so, Chris, will you have the band play and start?
Thank you, Reverend, for those enlightening words. And now I'd like to introduce Professor Richard Gonzalez, the President of North American Society, who will introduce the first speaker.
Thank you, Chris. On behalf of the Catalysis Society, I want to welcome you to Chicago. Before introducing the Hoodry Award awardee, I'd like to let you in on the results of an election that we had for officers. We have a new set of officers who take office on the 1st of July. And we had an election, and this was a not a Chicago-type election, but a real election. The results are for the chairman-elect is Alvin Ice, who could not be here. He's on sabbatical in Germany. The vice president is Alex Bell. The treasurer, continuing, is John Armour. We have a new secretary, Barbara Warren, and we have a new foreign secretary, who's Kirk Connie. It's been, for me, it's been a very rewarding 20 years, and I certainly wish the incoming officers as much as many rewards as I have had over the last 4 years. Today's Hoodry awardee is John Armour. John received his PhD from Stanford University in 1970 after getting a bachelor's from Penn State. His first job was in academia at Boston University, where he spent 4 years. He later on went to Air Products and then to, he went to Allied. No. Yeah, Allied Corporation, and then he is currently in their products. During his career, John has been responsible for a lot of discoveries in the area of new catalysts. In particular, he's been recognized for the discovery of a novel concept of oxygenation, for the conversion of cyclohexanone to hexacyclohexanone oxime, which is used to make nylon 6, cracking lipidine towards the production of N-linyl formamide, the selective hydrogenation of special organic amines, novel catalysts in the area of environmental catalysis, and an exchange zeolite catalyst for the reduction of NOx by methane. In particular, what strikes me about John is his, what I call his fantastic work. If you work with John as a co-officer in the Catalysis Society, you get emails at 1 o'clock in the morning, at 2 o'clock in the morning. He's a supremely diligent worker, very devoted to the Catalysis Society. Certainly put the treasury of the Catalysis Society in order. John also did an exceptionally good job as editor of Applied Catalysis for 9 years, and he certainly brought that journal to its current level. Today, John is going to talk about catalysis, particularly hydrogen catalysis. John?
Thank you, Dick, for those very kind remarks. I would also like to thank United Catalysts, who are sponsoring this award and have made this presentation possible. I also would like to just acknowledge that this is an award that I alone achieved, but really those that worked with me over many, many years, some of which are in the audience, so I want to thank those people as well. And I think many of you know who they are already. Over many years, I've ventured into many different areas of catalysis. I think if one wants to have an impact, you need to understand how catalysis fits into an entire process. And that's what I want to do today with regard to the manufacture of hydrogen. This is a new lecture today for me, and I'd like to begin by telling you why I have this interest in hydrogen. In the production of hydrogen, there is a lot of catalysis going on, more than just steam reforming, which is what we normally think of when we talk about hydrogen manufacturing. In the past years, because of my company's strong presence in the manufacture of hydrogen, I've learned a lot about the substantial application of catalysis in what is often viewed as a mature technology area. However, even mature technology areas, as others have pointed out, are very susceptible to step-out changes. What I'd like to do in this first slide to describe the outline is to discuss what today may seem to be old hat to some of you in this audience, who have worked in aspects of this area for the last 20 years. But let me assure you that there are opportunities in current, developing, and future approaches towards the manufacture of hydrogen. So I'd like to begin by telling you about the origin of my interest, bring all of us to a level playing ground with respect to how we make hydrogen, the current state of the art, if you will, and then get you to think about opportunities in current and alternative approaches to hydrogen production. Okay, so why the interest in hydrogen? Hydrogen is used widely, not only in the chemical industry, but in the food and refining industry. It's an environmentally clean fuel because of combustion, with the reaction with oxygen, you just produce water. There's no CO2 formation. And this is one of the reasons for the great interest in the production of hydrogen. It has a very high energy content and is often termed the fuel of the future, partly because we have a huge resource of hydrogen in our oceans. We can just figure out how to convert that water to hydrogen. Now, back in the late 1970s, this very well-known work by Marchetti talked about the transition over the more than the last 100 years as we move from one source of energy feedstock to another, first from wood, coal, to oil, to natural gas, and finally projecting non-fossil fuels becoming very dominant late in the 21st century. We've certainly seen coal rise and fall. I'm not sure that the plateau or the slope that's being accentuated here for oil is quite correct. We'll see later on that all these are a function of the economic forces, and in this case, the price of oil right now is very low, and that's continuing to extend, and our technologies for recovering oil are extending the impact of oil on energy production. However, it's also clear, I think, to most of us that natural gas is increasingly getting a lot more attention as a feedstock, and probably will begin to contribute more and more to the production of energy. But at some point, we'll run out of natural gas, that's clear. It won't be in our lifetime, probably, but it will be in our children's lifetime, our grandchildren's lifetime. And there will be a need for another fuel. It's typically referred to as non-fossil fuel. And I think Marchetti was talking at that time about nuclear. But I think most of us are very uncomfortable, not just us, but people throughout the world, with nuclear as an alternative fuel. And perhaps this is where a lot of interest in hydrogen is coming from, because if we could figure out how to convert hydrogen from readily available feedstock like water, we would have an infinite supply of hydrogen for a very long, long time, because you could recover and recycle that hydrogen as you burn it to make water and go back. Okay, so this slide is a summary published in 1996 on what's happening with regard to what we call hydrogen balance. In the 1980s, we saw that hydrogen was being produced largely by refineries. It was in surplus. They were able to sell it into the market. There was clearly yellow being demand, blue being production. The production was exceeding demand. But in the last 20 years, what we've seen is really just the opposite. We've seen an acceleration markedly in the demand for hydrogen. And it is forecast now into the 21st century that demand for hydrogen will continue and far outstrip the production, unless we make up that production. And indeed, there is a very large level right now of production of hydrogen plants throughout the world, and that will continue in order to meet the demands for hydrogen. Now, where is that demand for hydrogen coming from? A lot of it is coming from refinery desulfurization, hydrogen treating. Those are certainly two major components for consuming hydrogen. But there's also a great deal of hydrogen used in the production of chemicals, in toluidiamine and toluidiisocyanate, in the production of hydrogen peroxide. Any ammonia synthesis plant is really a hydrogen plant. You have to make that hydrogen to convert the nitrogen from water to ammonia. In the production of pharmaceuticals, especially hydrogenation throughout the chemical industry, in syngas, in the production of CO and hydrogen, there's a great deal of the demand for hydrogen, certainly for methanol synthesis and for higher alcohols. Beyond chemicals production, though, we also see the need for hydrogen in annealing steels, in the electronics area, in the fats and oil hydrogenation of food, which is a big consumer of hydrogen, and certainly for niche opportunities such as the power for these space shuttles we heard about yesterday. So we can see that the application of hydrogen has a broad impact on all aspects of our economy, not just the chemicals industry. Now, if we look at how hydrogen is produced today, you see that a good part of it, about half of it, comes from natural gas. About 30% of it comes from reforming or oxidation of petroleum. Much smaller amount from combustion of coal, and a surprisingly small number from the electrolysis of water to recycling. Electrolysis really isn't a major source of hydrogen, although one would think it'd be a very clean source as long as you have cheap hydroelectric energy. So keep those numbers in mind, and you'll understand where the focus of this lecture is going. Now, in considering the production of hydrogen, I think we all have to remember, because of the sources that I indicated in the previous slide, that there are co-products being produced whenever you're producing hydrogen. And a major co-product is carbon dioxide. It's produced in steam reforming operations where we use methane or a variety of hydrocarbons. And it's also produced in the partial oxidation approach in oxidizing hydrocarbons as a way of producing hydrogen. So both of these approaches produce large amounts of CO2 as well as hydrogen. Hydrogen are normally coming to a great extent from the addition of steam to the hydrogen. fire departments and the professional hygiene casino. Now, if one looks at the relative amounts of CO2 produced with hydrogen as a function of the various approaches, you see that in steam methane reforming, producing about 25% CO2, we start increasing the carbon value from pentanes, which reflect higher hydrocarbon feedstocks. Partial oxidation of methane, which is another popular approach, 33%. Partial oxidation of heavy oil. Finally, when you get to coal, about 50% of the gas product is CO2. So you can't ignore the fact that when we're producing hydrogen, we're also producing CO2. Now, because of that, I think it's apparent that we really can't use hydrogen today as a way of controlling carbon dioxide. This is chemistry that's actually quite easy to do. We can react hydrogen with CO2, and people have suggested that, gee, this would be a nice way of removing CO2. But you can see that as long as most of our hydrogen produces CO2 in the process of that production operation, you're not really going to achieve anything by controlling CO2 and hydrogen, not on a large scale. There may be micro areas around the world where it might be advantageous to do so, but not in this particular case. Now, if we get eventually to an economy where hydrogen is produced from non-fossil fuels, hydrogen is cheap, we might consider using it to destroy CO2. But if you can remember a few slides ago about the application of hydrogen throughout the world in various industries, hydrogen has a lot of value in the production of other chemicals, in the production of food, and in the refining industry. And so you're going to have to justify that value as opposed to using it to remove carbon dioxide, which is another issue that we have to wrestle with, even if you have a non-fossil plentiful source of hydrogen. Okay, so one of the most popular approaches, as I indicated earlier, is steam methane reforming. This is a reaction of methane and steam through CO and hydrogen. Now, it turns out that you're really not just making CO and hydrogen, you're making CO2 and hydrogen. You've got unreacted steam, you've got some unreacted methane, you've got some nitrogen in that stream. And so you have to ultimately separate the hydrogen from the rest of the products. And if you want to make hydrogen, which is what I'm talking about, and not mixture of hydrogen and CO, presently, one of the more popular approaches is to apply what's called PSA, pressure swing adsorption, which uses adsorbent beds to purify the hydrogen and produce pure hydrogen at high pressure. Now, in order to run PSA, you have to run pressure generally 200 to 400 PSI in these PSA units. And that's desirable, actually, from the product point of view, because the customer for the hydrogen, which is by and large the refining industry, wants high-pressure hydrogen. There's not a desire for low-pressure hydrogen, by and large. So because you need high-pressure hydrogen, this is continuing to fuel this more interesting approach of using PSA in the newer hydrogen plants that are being constructed. The other thing to appreciate is the temperature. Steam methane reforming reaction is an endothermic reaction. It runs in excess of 750 to 800 degrees centigrade. And because of that, you need fairly exotic alloys just to contain the catalyst. You have to have fairly thick walls because you're running at very high temperatures and high pressures. And because of the endothermicity of the reaction, you have to burn a lot of natural gas just to heat your reactors together. So steam methane reforming, there are a lot of things that impact type of catalysis that we select in producing hydrogen. Now, there are a lot of approaches to operating the production of hydrogen plants, and we have to realize that there really isn't one process flow diagram that conveniently describes how we make hydrogen. And I try to take one here, which brings components of several together. One brings in natural gas. And because natural gas feedstocks often have some sulfur, you often have to remove that sulfur by hydrogen, by zinc oxide. You then go through what we call a pre-reformer, and I'll explain that. You then go through your primary steam reformer operation, then you do high temperature shift, and then you do the PSA for the production of pure hydrogen product. Now, if you look at that, there are really several steps which are very different in their operation. salt removal involves operation on 350 degrees C, curing reforming about 500 degrees C, steam reforming 800 plus degrees C, high temperature shift back down to 350, and PSA 30 degrees C. So you're bringing the temperature of your reactants up and down throughout this process. And it really becomes not just a hydrogen plant, but a steam plant. Most of the steam is made in the primary reform. You have to heat this methane and steam up to 800 degrees C. You're blasting catalyst tubes with natural gas burners. And so what you end up doing is generating a lot of surplus heated product. You don't need it at 800 degrees to go hydrogen shift, you need it at 350. So they use steam to recover heat. They also use steam to recover some of the heat as you go from 350 to 30 degrees here. And then that steam is used to, if you will, preheat the feed into the desulfurizing unit and also preheat the feed into the reformer as well as the reformer. So there's a lot of heat balance in these plants. And even so, there's a lot of excess steam. So producers of hydrogen are also producers of steam, trying to find other people who want to use high pressure steam as value. So, in looking at steam methane reforming, we talk about natural gas as a traditional feedstock. It has to be hydrogenated because you can't handle the patterns of olefins in that stream. The olefins will lead to coking of your catalyst. You have to do then desulfurization of resulting H2S. You do this pre-reforming for heat recovery and again to remove higher components which lead to coking. You generate 10 to 12 tons of steam for every ton of hydrogen. Finally, you get down into steam methane reforming, methane and water, CO and hydrogen. And because you want to make hydrogen, you then take the CO and you react with steam or gas shift to CO2 and hydrogen. And again, more steam because it's an exothermic reaction. And then at 30 degrees, you do a PSA. Now, in some operations, they'll use a means as ways of stripping CO2. We'll also do some finishing steps by doing methanation, reaction of CO and methane, to destroy low levels of CO, which are killers for people who use the hydrogen. So you can see that there are a number of catalytic steps involved in production of hydrogen, not just steam methane reform. And what about natural gas? This isn't what I mean by natural gas. Natural gas is a much dirtier material. If you look at the traditional regional composition of natural gas throughout the world, let me just pick a few here. In California, it might be 89% methane. It's got a good deal of ethane, propane, and other higher hydrocarbons, about 0.5% of CO2. But look at New Zealand. That natural gas in New Zealand is about 44% methane. It's got about 12% in the region between C2 and C5, 44% CO2. If you look at Iraqi natural gas, 56% methane, 7% plus H2S, only 3% CO2. If you look at the Russian fields here, you see 85% natural gas, about 10% in the C2, C3 areas. So you're dealing with a feedstock, which is quite dirty and quite barren. And so how do you build hydrogen plants to handle this feedstock? Well, it's going to vary from one location in the United States, certainly one location within Europe. Now, what this leads to are really many competing reactions to steam methane reforming. And again, this brings out a lot of different catalysts. Not just in reaction one, which is what we traditionally mean by steam methane reforming, but you've got the water gas shift, you've got the reverse water gas shift, you've got carbon formation, that is the decomposition of CO. The CO2 and carbon, or the decomposition of methane into carbon and hydrogen. They're really killers in this catalysis. We'll talk about that. You've got other hydrocarbons undergoing reforming reactions. You've got CO2 and methane to produce CO and hydrogen. You've got CO2, methane, and steam to produce CO and hydrogen. And you're also stripping sulfur out of the oxide. And there are probably some other reactions that one can envision along the way here. But these are certainly ones of some of the more important ones we have to worry about. Now, I mentioned that there's an operation called pre-reforming, which is enjoying a lot of interest nowadays, because it is really a nice way of trying to clean up the additional natural gas fees. And it has the other advantages in minimizing or reducing fuel consumption by reducing the workload of the primary reformer. You also generate steam in the operation to make more hydrogen earlier in the reaction, so that helps in your heat recovery. But more importantly, you're generating fairly constant operating conditions in this primary reformer. This primary reformer, it's a high-nickel catalyst, not the same as you use in traditional steam methane reforming, but the same type of operation, and it allows you to run with increased flexibility. This is a chart that gives you an idea of the typical composition going in and out of this pre-reformer following the desulfurization. Catalyst runs lower, about 500 degrees C, it's an endothermic reaction. Pressures, 33 atmospheres. This is very important in any of these hydrogen operations. Not only the hydrogen that you produce and you have to purify pressure, but you've got to run these reactions at pressure, because you don't want to do unnecessary compression in your final product. Methane comes in about 93% in this particular feed stream, comes out at 72%. Let's see what happens to C2s and C3s. They just get wiped out. And that's very important because those are primary co-formers if they see your catalyst in the reformer they have to receive. You make hydrogen, which is good. You make a little bit of CO, you make a little bit of CO2. So what this pre-reformer operation does, it starts to make some hydrogen for you and destroys your C2s and C3s, which are your coking. Now, we get into the main operation, finally, the methane reformer. Typically, you're running catalysts on the order of 800 degrees centigrade. These reformers are identified from the distance from the highway. They're just huge furnaces. The boxes are about three stories high. They contain anywhere from 400 to 600 tubes, depending on the size of the operation. They run at about 300 pounds pressure. The tubes themselves are 45 feet long. They're heavy wall tubes. They've got a 5-inch ID. They're made of microalloys, high nickel alloy compositions. And it's important to appreciate that these catalysts run for in the order of 4 to 5 years. They're already very good catalysts for steam methane reforming. I think you need to appreciate how they're used and how they operate, and that's what this slide is intended to illustrate. By the way, I think most of you have noticed now that I'm trying to reference heavily throughout the lecture here, and most of the work that I have talking about today can be found in different pieces of the literature, except for some of the overview that I'm going to provide later. Now, okay, we've used the catalyst, we've pre-reformed, we've stripped the sulfur, we need to now worry about heat flux. Because the other important thing about these very endothermic reactions is that you really become heat transfer limited. You just can't get enough heat fast enough to the catalyst to make it do a job. About 50% of the heat for the combustion heat is used for the reaction. The rest is used for recovering and preheating, generating steam. If your temperature runs a little lower, you have to use a lot more extra catalyst. If your tube wall thicknesses are thicker than you'd like, again, then you're not getting enough heat in, so that lowers your temperature of operation. On the other hand, if you can improve your heat flux, engineering issue, you can reduce the number of tubes in methane reforms. So there's a lot of design still underway in many of the major operators of these types of plants to do just this. Now, back to the catalyst. We find that obviously these catalysts are going to operate for 4 to 5 years. They must be fairly stable and tolerant of not only normal operating conditions, but startup. Because in startup, the composition may not necessarily be the same as when they're running full out. There are transients in the operation. Again, natural gas isn't clean, and it doesn't always come in the same quality as it did 2 days ago. So you've got to worry about being able to run a catalyst which can take varying compositions of feedstock. This year, catalyst life, and the commercial and conventional catalysts now are these alkaline promoted nickel on alkaline catalysts. A number of very good ones out there manufactured by ICI and Calco, by UCI, a number of the major catalyst companies are manufacturing these materials. So they're really available. But there are improvements that are possible, and I'll talk about that. One of the things that we need to appreciate seeing them in reappointing. This begins to get a decision of what can we do is carbon formation. Certainly, the Boudoir reaction for generating carbon has been going for a long time, and certainly not making compositions for a long time. But carbon formation is really a question of genetics, the process condition of reactor design. Remember, this endothermic reaction is just these 600 tubes, if you will, aren't running isothermal. It's an adiabatic reaction. You've got a temperature profile on the top of this 45-foot tube down to the bottom, which is very considerable. And so you've got a series of temperature zones. You've got reactants and products varying in composition throughout the bed. So at the very top of that bed, methane and water react to produce CO and hydrogen. Further down, you begin to get CO2 coming in, and now you start getting CO2 and methane reactions. And you get a variety of reactions going on down this tube at a variety of temperatures. So looking at these reactions isothermally is not the way to understand how these catalysts perform. So in understanding the fundamental principles that surround the methane reforming, I think we need to see more work at higher pressures. A lot of the work that was published in the literature is done at one atmosphere because it's convenient to do that. But as I said, we don't produce hydrogen in one atmosphere. By and large, we produce it at much higher pressures, 10 to 20 atmospheres. And when you do that, those pressures, you need to appreciate the kinetics and the mechanisms are very considerable, because we're dealing with an adiabatic system, not an isothermal system. And so there are a lot of competitive reactions going on in a variety of temperature zones. So this becomes a very difficult process of control. But because it's been operating for so many years, we can do this. We know how to control these reactions to some extent. Long term of life of operation is always important to any catalyst, and they fail, or they fail because of nickel sintering or carbon deposition. Again, we have to appreciate there are competitive reactions going on. If you're going to look at steam methane reforming, you've got to look at it with some CO2 added, you've got to look at it with a little bit of sulfur maybe, depending on how well you strip your sulfur. There are also thermal reactions going on. We worry about the catalysis, but this gas comes out of the reformer at 800 degrees C. It's still pretty hot. And there's a lot of thermal temperature that still belongs to walls, molecules themselves, those temperatures. Certainly, there are issues with regard to poisons. And finally, we need to understand chemistry and catalysis at very high temperatures. Now, that would mean that most of us are used to operating at temperatures of 200, 400 degrees centigrade. When you're running at 800 degrees C, there's a lot going on. There's thermal chemistry, there's wall chemistry, there's all sorts of things. And I'm not sure that we fully appreciate all that's happening in these systems. We can control them, but we may not understand the control of them. Another important thing, which, again, we know how to operate, are these alkaline-related catalysts, because this is not a catalyst that just sits there and doesn't change. It's actually, that alkaline is a catalyst mobile. It's moving around. It's migrating off the catalyst bed. And so you've got to worry about issues of corrosion, in fact, the catalyst is changing its history. So not only are those reactions to different temperatures, you've got different catalysts for the finest. Okay, so that's really all I want to say about steam methane reforming. What I'd like to do is talk about the thermal oxidation of fossil fuels now, partial oxidation of hydrocarbons is another major approach to making hydrogen. The catalyst, as I said, is about 30% of hydrogen production now. The advantage of this is that one can accept all kinds of hydrogen hydrocarbon feeds in the production of hydrogen. And basically, what you're doing is a thermal oxidation. You're taking any type of hydrocarbon, heating at about 1300 degrees C. You don't need a catalyst, I'm just saying CO and hydrogen. You may have some post-catalyst afterward, produce some more reforming, depending on how you set up this operation. You make lots of coke, which forces you to do more work to remove that coke. Turns out, remember that you're using oxygen. Now, this brings out another point. Because we're making hydrogen, we can't use air. If you use air, you've got a lot of nitrogen. We're talking about reactions of pressure. You have to compress all that excess nitrogen, which you don't want, and you have to clean out your stream. So because of that, people use oxygen plants. Now, although oxygen in air is free, there certainly isn't free to separate that oxygen from air. This is fairly mature technology. Oxygen plants can be expensive, depending on how they're situated around the world. And so to operate thermal oxidation, you need an oxygen plant next to an hydrogen plant. You still need to carry out the water gas shift because you have to take the CO to make hydrogen. You do water gas shift then. You have to do gas purification. You're making H2S. You have to clean up the carbon dioxide. So those are additional steps. And although it doesn't look like it on this slide, which is like low on steam methane reforming, in balance, versus steam methane reforming, thermal oxidation requires much more energy and it produces more CO2. Its attraction, that is, because of its greater flexibility. You use higher hydrocarbons, you can use bottom of barrel feedstocks, which are becoming readily available. So there is an interest building in this approach as well. Okay, so those are the ways we primarily make hydrogen. Now I'd really like to get to the second part of this talk, which talks about how else can we make hydrogen. Now, I think you can begin to appreciate that in looking at natural gas and petroleum-based feedstocks, they're still relatively low-cost fuels, so that one can use them for a while, and they'll be a way to continually generate hydrogen in the immediate future. But if you look at down the road, what's going to happen? Steam methane reforming, any reforming operation, is still a very energy-intensive operation. Large quantities of carbon dioxide are produced, nobody likes that. Hydrogen purification is necessary. Produce hydrogen without doing a lot of additional purification, people would be much more interested in that. And if we could produce hydrogen at elevated pressures readily, that's very desirable. In the reforming operations, we're talking about endothermic reactions. In the oxidation reactions, there are exothermic reactions, but you have to keep them at very high temperature. And again, keep in mind, we still have to make hydrogen at pressure. So focusing on making hydrogen when atmosphere is not the solution. Okay, so I have a list here of alternative ways of producing hydrogen. And unfortunately, I'm not really happy with any of them. But let me just tell you what they are. We'll go through some of these. CO2 reforming of methane, we'll talk about use of methane as a source of hydrogen, using membranes as a way of purifying hydrogen streams, solar energy for electrolysis of water, selective oxidation of methane, oxidative dehydrogenation, electrolysis of fuel cells, and biomass conversion. I won't talk about biomass conversion. It's very straightforward. Just heating plants up and generating CO and hydrogen, CO2 and hydrogen. And there are some references here to electrolysis. I won't spend a lot of time on this. I think in this list, if we talk about this non-fossil fuel area that we have to face probably in the 22nd century, we need to begin to think about, you know, how we're going to do that. And I'm not sure that there is any good way here except maybe the policies of water. And I'll talk about that in a short while. Okay, for CO2 and methane, this is not what I mean. Okay? We can't, as I pointed out, use natural gas because it's not clean. You have to clean it up. We can't do CO2 as such from an exhaust stream for the same reason. CO2 from a furnace contains nitrogen, contains oxygen, contains CO, contains a little sulfur. You have to clean that carbon dioxide up. You have to raise the pressure to get it to react. And so that CO2 has to be handled in some way. The catalyst meant to generate, generate methane. Obviously, we're not going to use them to generate our methane, but I've talked about the importance of the fact that natural gas is not methane, but it's a composition of a variety of materials. Okay, now it turns out CO2 methane reforming is undergoing a great deal of interest right now in the literature. Very straightforward reaction with ideally produced syngas, CO and hydrogen, depending on how we're going to use that syngas. A key problem in the operation of this reaction alone is carbon formation. Saw it in steam methane reforming, and it really comes out of stage here, unless you're really careful about the operation. But part of it, the reason is, because you're making CO, and CO at high pressures and these temperatures is going to decompose to generate carbon. So you've got to learn to control that carbon formation. That's a Russian. Now it turns out, Palo Alto has process that already operates largely with recycled CO as a way of running this reaction, CO2 and methane, as an entry written here. And they use a sulfur poison nickel catalyst for an operation. But there's already some small application of this reaction in the industry for producing hydrogen or producing hydrogen CO. Okay, now, this issue of carbon formation is, it really gets to be a problem working with this reaction. But I want to make sure that people understand what's going on here. This is a plot of what we call dry reform, which is just CO2 and methane and CO and hydrogen, as I had in the previous slide. Pressure versus temperature. Everything to the left of the line corresponds to the region we're going to make carbon. And so you get it, you get it. So if we look at a ratio of CO2 to methane of 2, and this dotted line reflects the typical pressures that we want to make hydrogen, so that's another fixed point, we can see that if we're going to feed in a ratio of excess CO2 to methane, we're going to have to run at somewhere close to 900 degrees C just to avoid carbon formation. Indeed, that's what you have to do in the COPSOAP process if you want to make hydrogen and CO at that particular ratio. Now, you can see that if you could run with a richer CO2 to methane stream, so you go from 4 to 6, you can begin to lower that temperature to maybe 800 degrees C. And that's useful also because it reduces the cost in terms of the alloys, the operation, the issues of the thickness of the wall that you need because of the high temperature reaction and pressure that you're using. So one can raise the ratio of CO2 to methane. But what are you going to have to do? You want to make hydrogen. You only need a mole of CO2 for every mole of methane. So you're going to have this excess CO2 around. So even though you can run an excess CO2 to methane to help your carbon formation, it's going to come back and get you later on. Now, the other important thing I want to point out here, where's one atmosphere? It's down here. I would say the majority of the work coming out now in the literature is at one atmosphere of CO2 and methane. What I want to do is encourage people, although this is tougher, to do this at higher pressure. And this is why. We're going to do chemistry at one atmosphere. Look where we're going to operate. We'll just stay above 750 degrees C and we won't get carbon formation. But in principle, remember, we need that hydrogen at pressure. So we need to understand how it operates above 900 degrees C. As soon as you start going to those sorts of temperatures, you've got thermal reactions, you've got other competing reactions that you have to worry about. So, while it's useful to get that data in one atmosphere, it's even more important to get it at elevated pressure to appreciate the competitive reactions that occur. Okay, so, in summary, with regard to CO2 methane, there's a lot of interest right now in generating catalysts which minimize carbon formation, such as by putting in on landfill or zirconium or using precious metals instead of plastic. Using promoters may also enhance that performance. I think we need a higher degree of the mechanism, understanding the mechanism of kinetics. Remember, we're dealing with reactions here where temperature is varying down at catalyst 2. We're looking at ratios of CO2 to methane, which are higher than we really want, but we operate that way to minimize carbon formation. We have to begin to worry about the cost of that carbon dioxide and how we're going to get it into the reaction system. With regard to carbon deposition, which I've been talking about, there have been some studies looking at carbon deposition in one atmosphere. I know it's tough, but we need to look at carbon deposition at elevated pressures. We can monitor how carbon is being formed, how to minimize that carbon with a variety of catalysts at 20 atmospheres in this variety of mixtures of CO2 and methane and CO and steam. It's a composite that you've got to look at. It makes it even tougher. That's when you begin to be able to control carbon deposition better than you can now. And this issue of scale testing isn't anything that I know is easy to do. But we're talking about reactions that catalysts have run through years of life here. But to go from a tenth of a gram to several grams is a big step. To go from powder to extruding is a big step. And we really need better ways of getting there faster, being able to extrapolate from powder to a pellet at these temperatures and these pressures with these large metal catalysts at low surface areas of support. Okay, so
switch to some of these other approaches to making hydrogen.
Got
catalytic mechanism analysis. Harman summarized this recently at this conference in 1936. Here you're just taking methane and you're decomposing into hydrogen and saturants. Again, carbon formation is the killer here. You need to control this reaction. You need thin catalyst beds, things with high energy. This is really at the cutting edge of the catalysis right now. So you have to figure out how to get that energy into the system, get that reaction to occur without getting a lot of carbon deposition. And they've talked about some fairly elegant approaches using fluidized beds to get rolling and worrying about methane flusses and things like that. Now, another popular approach is to use membranes as a way of producing hydrogen, but really the membrane can only treat a gas stream. You're not going to do chemistry there. But nonetheless, there are a lot of process streams which contain some hydrogen, which is useless because it may have some CO in it, or it may have some steam in it, or whatever. And so membranes do offer you a way of getting that hydrogen out of that process stream. And so for that approach, you know, membranes can be attractive. But again, there are some limitations I want to point out. If you're going to use palladium metal, or palladium metal alloys, as a way of cleaning up and purifying hydrogen, you need to appreciate palladium is going to be sensitive to CO, H2S, and everything. So you've got to worry about what else is in that hydrogen stream if you're going to try to use palladium metal alloys. Membranes are going to often be mass transport limited. Getting that hydrogen through the membrane wall quick enough produce the hydrogen you want, and pressure and concentration permeate side. You've got naturally low working surface area with any membrane, which is going to mean you have to large size systems. You've got issues of balance because in a membrane you can't coat the walls, you can't plug the walls because you'll limit their performance. With palladium membranes, again, you're going to produce pure hydrogen, but you're generally going to produce hydrogen at lower pressure. Remember, I said we need hydrogen at higher pressure. So there's an inconsistency there. And then there's a hurdle. And also, right now, with many of the palladium membranes, we require the light. Because if you're going to come up with another way to make hydrogen, you've got to make it more attractive than the way to make it now. We make it now by running these plants for years. And these palladium alloys simply don't have that light at this point in terms of failure. You all get catastrophic failure with hydrogen we don't want. Finally, there's the polymer membrane approach, which is a way to use hydrogen to purify it with certain streams, but it's limited to the composition of the stream that you're dealing with, and it is another approach to producing pure hydrogen, but it's very selective that you can use it because of that. Now, I think this is probably our biggest opportunity, but it's also our toughest opportunity. If we can satisfy that age-old dream that people have been talking about for decades now, using solar energy, solar light, to irradiate a cell containing water, produce hydrogen and oxygen, and recover that hydrogen as a way of generating power, that probably would be the most attractive breakthrough approach you could come up with. But there are enormous hurdles here. I don't want to simplify this task, and people have worked on it for many years, but this is probably better than most other approaches that are available now for non-fossil fuel approaches. If you're going to work in this area, you've got to do it with visible light. I know it's easy to do with ultraviolet light, but visible light is what we're going to be using. We're going to use solar energy in the surface of the earth, on the oceans, on the desert, with some sort of cell. You've got to measure quantum yields. Again, I know this isn't easy to do, but when you're running heterogeneous photochemistry, you've got to measure quantum yields because you have to understand just how efficient your reactions perform. And there's technology that has to come up here just to do that, let alone carry out the chemistry. You need to have these operations cost effective. You can't use some exotic metal in your silicon solar cell if you're going to have to cover hundreds of acres of desert or ocean with these cells. Another important thing is co-product. Again, you don't want to irradiate water and produce hydroxide ion also. You have to neutralize hydroxide ion. So you've got to cleanly associate water into hydrogen and oxygen if you want to use this approach. And then you also got to worry about catalyst life. When I talk about real environments here,
Now consider these solar cells sitting on the surface of a desert, and you got a dust storm. The dust storm covers the cell. How are you going to get that dust off that cell? If you're laying these cells down on the ocean surface, which people have talked about, you've got saltwater springs that cover those cells. So you've got to begin to think about the total operation, not just the catalysis unit. But nonetheless, if one can begin to solve some of these problems, this is going to take a while. There's an opportunity. Okay, now, that's a non-fossil fuel approach. But perhaps one of the more attractive methane-based approaches is partial oxidation. And that's generating a renewed level of intensity right now for the partial catalytic oxidation of methane to CO and hydrogen separately here. Lanny Schmidt told us several years ago about some very remarkable work using rhodium monoliths for carrying out this sort of reaction. And for those that aren't aware, there's a recent Shell patent, which certainly elevates this, I think, to another level. Now we've been able to use a very low level of rhodium on zirconium, about 1,000 degrees C, admittedly still at lower pressure, and the pressure is up, using a fairly tortuous catalyst, in this case, ceramic foam. We get very high conversions of methane to selectivities of 90% and better than CO and hydrogen. So we'll have to see how this develops, whether it has the light, whether it has to get its operative pressures, with a concern for safety of our system. In another piece of related work, there's some work that just came out by Tania Figueroa, which talks about a model system, again, for partial oxidation. This is very intriguing. They found that these perovskites would do some of this chemistry, but if you had a gadolinium with the perovskite, you got a marked improvement in conversion. At 30 degrees C, you get 73% conversion and 80% selectivity. It's really very good at this particular stage. Okay, what are the hurdles? You've got the helium in the stream. You're not going to be able to deal with helium in the stream if you're going to produce hydrogen. So we've got to figure out a way of how we're going to overcome this helium problem. You can't add a helium to this operation because it's too expensive as a way of making hydrogen. And then you have to separate the helium from the hydrogen. So we've got to consider the separation issues, safety. We're talking about methane and oxygen. Very high temperatures, very high pressures. You're going to be above the explosion in the region, you're going to go down through it. There are all sorts of things that can go wrong. You're going to figure out how to operate these systems. They've got to be demonstrated over a longer period of life than they have been right now. And there's certainly opportunities for supporting these catalysts in a way of improving their performance. The last topic I have here is solid oxide fuel cells. Again, this is some work coming out of the Noah Severs group. Very nice electrochemical oxidation of methane to syngas using a platinum electrode catalyst on a porous oxygen conducting zirconium electrode. Just use a dense oxygen transporting membrane coated with platinum, and you can catalyze the combustion of methane at 700 degrees C in one atmosphere. You've got to get that pressure up again, getting very high conversions of oxygen, hydrogen, CO, converting the methane to about 50%. For the bonus here, you're getting electricity co-generated in the So there's an opportunity here. The problems are you've got to reduce the operation temperature of that oxygen transport membrane, which is a significant material thermal. You've got to raise this reaction to higher pressures. You've got to demonstrate light and other issues, but it certainly is something that's cutting edge and may, in the long run, prove significant. Okay, so those are the chemical approaches. Now, I mentioned at the beginning of my talk about hydroelectric power as a way of generating hydrogen. It certainly is one that we want to say, hey, using electricity is a great way of generating hydrogen. It is if you're not using, obviously, a fossil fuel. But if you're using a fossil fuel, you've got to worry about CO2, nuclear, other environmental concerns. But as I told some people when I was in Brazil about a month ago, I was watching CNN one night, and along comes this feature story about dams as a way of generating hydroelectric power. And I learned more than I've seen in a lot of literature in these next few little items. It turns out that if one uses a dam as a way of generating power, while it may seem like a very acceptable approach, you're going to have an impact on riverbed fish, the green group of like this. You're going to have alterations of temperature, pH, and nutrients in the vicinity of the dam, blocking the river flow. You're going to lose that surface area that the dam fills in creating the backup buildings of the dam. And surprisingly, I wasn't aware that there are a considerable level of public safety issues. These dams do fail. They will collapse. They sometimes will collapse catastrophically. So there are all sorts of other issues with regard to the construction of dams, and they don't represent a long-term solution to power integration. They provide micro-solutions in certain regions of the world where river water is plentiful and where you're willing to accept these alternatives. But as a way of generating hydrogen, a long-range solution. Okay, the other approach is I think we need to appreciate issues that don't impact the way we carry out our analysis. This is the last point I want to make. We've talked about types of feedstocks in producing hydrogen, natural gas, heavy oil, etc. These are very regionally dependent. If you're in a part of the world which has a very natural gas, lots of methane in it, you don't want to use that. If it's got a lot of CO2, you may not want to use it. So that how you choose your approach to making hydrogen can depend on the feedstock in that region. Partial oxidation, POX as we call it here, is a popular way of making hydrogen. But again, you need an oxygen plant, which is no simple task or investment if you're going to carry on this technology. We have to think about in the industry, and I'm talking about customers. We may develop the greatest technology in the world. As I said, it operates in one atmosphere, and nobody's going to want it. Because the customer, in this case, wants to buy hydrogen at pressure, often wants it very, very pure, because you don't want to destroy those catalysts downstream, which are poisoned by other things in hydrogen. And you want huge volumes of hydrogen, which involves a good deal of investment, capital, and whatever. You don't worry about the cost of power. As I said, these are by and large endothermic reactions that came out of the reforming. You've got to justify the huge amounts of power that you're going to put in to keep that gas. You've got to worry about capital. You can't use linear accelerators to make hydrogen. It's not one of your cheaper approaches to getting energy in there. You've got to worry about storage, separation, and purification. Now, those are sort of tangential things, but when people come up with breakthrough ways of storing hydrogen, purifying it, and separating it, that's going to impact the route that we choose to make the hydrogen. As you can see, we have a number of approaches. And a lot of them differ by what else is in the product gas. Environmental regulations are also going to be a driver here. What countries dictate in terms of emissions is going to impact how we produce hydrogen. And certainly, certain countries which are willing to make the investment in taxes, government subsidies are also going to influence the way it's hydrogen. Now, I don't want to say that, you know, we as chemists, analysis scientists, can do anything to control these issues. But I just want to say that we need to be aware of it. We can't operate in a vacuum and say, well, we're going to do the best chemistry in the world and not appreciate the companies that are going to use it because it's totally out of application. So finally, I'd just like to summarize the points that I tried to make today. I think it's fairly apparent that there is a very strong demand for hydrogen. There are many catalytic operations within steam methane reforming. I hope I've shown you that today. Within steam reforming, while it's a mature technology, it is fertile ground. One needs to carry out more reactions, more studies at higher pressures, because that's where we're running in. We need to understand that if we're going to benchmark new catalyst improvements against current catalysts, these current catalysts are already pretty good. And you're going to have to measure them under realistic benchmarking conditions over extended periods of time to make that assessment. Try to point out that there are a number of alternative approaches beyond steam reforming and thermal oxidation. And probably there's only one good one, which is non-fossil fuel. But there are huge breakthroughs that are needed in order to get there. I've also tried to point out to you that in coming up with new catalysis and learning in this area, you have to consider the entire process. Separations, energy balances, feed quality, whatever you're undertaking. project which is focused at some technology improvement. I've also tried to point out that hydrogen is not a way of removing CO2 in any big scale because of the co-product of CO2 that's made when we make most of our hydrogen. And the final point here, the production route that we choose for any product, whether it be hydrogen or ethylene or anything we really make as a chemical itself, it's going to be dependent not only on the science, the technology, but it's going to be dependent on the economics, the cost of feedstock, the cost of the capital there. We as scientists can't do much about that except to operate within reasonable cost-driving operations. And the markets, which again, we can't do much about except to be alert to what those markets are. So doing talented science, doing it for the production of hydrogen, we need to be aware of what's going on with regard to the economics and the markets, as well as opportunities for the technology. And that's what I'm trying to touch on. So thank you for your attention.
Reconfigure the rules and move out of the coffee break. Thank you.